You know that? That little building? That was a temple to Nike, the goddess Nike. That's where the shoes gets its name. You're wearing shoes dedicated to a god if you got on Nikes. Because what that means is the god of victory. Got wings, the god of victory. All these gods cohabitated, I guess, up there, if you want to call them that. I call them demonic forces because that's what they were identified as. We have all these stadiums, and we have arenas, and we have the Acropolis right here, and then we have the Olympian area, and that's this area over here. The Areopagus was right here. That was where all the trading places that you would go if you went to buy goods. That was a grocery store. Safeway was there, I'm sure. Now, out towards some of the hills, we had lots of other structures that were very huge theater structures and all that stuff. But here we get finally up to the stadium that they had built there. And this is in Athens, and this is in 1920. They had the World Olympics there. And I don't know if you know this or not. Greece was a warring place, and all nations went to war every spring. That's what they did. They raised babies so that they could have war. There was all these city-states that were there. You had Spartans. Remember Spartacus? He was a Spartan. He was in that Peloponnesian area that I pointed to, that peninsula. That's where Spartica is. There was a guy that came along, Lugurcius, I think was his name, about 950 B.C. That was before Christ. They call it B.C.E. now. I don't know why they do that. I guess they wanted to get rid of A.D., which means after Christ's death, you know. They've done away with that, and they call it C.E. And I think, man, you guys are headed for bad news, because he's the one that divided all the points of time. All time exists around him. Either the world was waiting on him to come, or the world celebrating that he had come. Somebody wanted to change that, and somebody's going to be in trouble when they stand before God. Anyway, this area here, this man that lived somewhere between 950 B.C., hey, that was the time of Elijah calling down fire from heaven. Ahab was in charge of Israel. Ahab and Jezebel was there on site. And while that was going on, they were having some problems over here. All these city-states were constantly getting tangled up with each other. And so they went to Apollo, which was one of the gods, and they went to the Delphi girls. You remember where the Delphi girls were, or who they were? That Delphi's were connected to the gods. There's a place that they would go, and they inquire of the Delphi. And the way they would inquire is someone would go. There was literally a fissure in the earth. There's still a fissure in the earth there, and there's these volcanic gases that come up, and somebody would go over and put their nose and their head down in that hole, and then they'd come up, you know, screaming and all this stuff, insane, hooked up on this loco gas. And then, fortunately, they had somebody that could interpret. Now, you think tongues are bad? Try screeching. So we had screech interpreters back then for Apollo, and a creed and a constitution was supposed to have been delivered to this guy for Greece. But along with that creed came this thing that the reason there's all these wars and you got all these problems is you've abandoned your gods. Therefore, I want you to have games every year, not every year, every 4 years. And of those games, it begins with the women, and get them set up in wrestling, and get them set up in spear checking, and get them set up in running. And the winner of that gets to be the high priestess to Apollo. Then the men, when they run, the winner of that gets to be the consort of the high priestess. Now, that was some of the origins of these games starting. It was because the gods didn't like what they were doing, so they wanted to be worshipped at those games, and they wanted everybody to put aside their differences and come and worship them. This is after the order of the Delphi girls, I call them that. So you can see there's a little background here. Now, with that came a whole set of rules. And the rules were, one, in order to participate in the games, you had to be of Grecian descent. You couldn't be a foreigner. You had to belong to the country. You had to be born there. You couldn't be suspect of like born somewhere else. You had to be a native in order to participate in the games. Also, you had to come together in a gymnasium and you had to literally train for 10 months. Then you possibly could get qualified to be in these games, which would please the gods, which would cause your crops to grow and would stop the wars and so forth and so on. Now, the reason I'm giving you all this is because Paul outlines a vivid illustration to the Corinthians, one that they could fully understand and that they could take into immediate application in relationship to the living God which they had met. He wasn't just pulling some illustration out of the air. He was pulling something forward that had a set of defined rules that now they could begin to understand of how to get on in a relationship with the Lord. How to get on and know God and to realize we're headed somewhere. We're supposed to be headed somewhere. If we're just a little sheep locked in our own little house, we're not headed anywhere. But the enemy's headed for us. But there's supposed to be purposes behind this. And his application in the scriptures that's listed above in 1 Corinthians 9, 23 through 27 is running, which was Olympic, training, which was Olympic, and winning, which was Olympic. Everything he had to do with the Olympics. And keep in mind, there were some things written about the Olympics in 746 B.C. There was some things being said about the men and their participation and welcome to the 114th Olympic Games. Well, 114 times 4, that puts you back 400 years before when it started. And that's why they kind of know about the time that the Games started and why they started. All these different poets and historians and stuff wrote little things that have been put together about these things. But to them, it was their life. It was the only thing that was going to appease to God. It was the only thing that was going to make them strong enough to defeat other nations. It was the only thing that was going to help them keep their city-states established. They had city-states, and each one was an independent city-state. So there was constant conflict between them, but there was also constant conflict with the Persians. And one of the things that was stated in 746 B.C. by, I don't remember the guy's name, was that, ladies, you need to get involved in this more and more and more, and we want to make sure you understand you're supposed to be down here wrestling. You find that strange? It wasn't mud wrestling. It was wrestling. And you're supposed to be down there throwing spears. And if they would meet you on the street and I said, where are you going? Well, I got to go pick up Susie and we got to go to the gymnasium. We're going to go. They knew what you were going to do. You were going to go wrestle. Or you were going to go run. Or you were going to go. There was a lady that won the chariot races. I think it was in 326 B.C. And boy, I'm telling you, that lady went on to be like the consort to the king. And got all kinds of elevations because she won the chariot races. And this was some serious, serious stuff. You can see, I showed you the stadium. They built that thing for this stuff. They built that thing because God said, if you don't do this, we're going to constantly give you problems and plague you. And this is a way that you can serve us. And the reason I'm giving you and pushing so much history down your throat is because Paul is fixing to make some dynamic statements to these people and they fully understand what he was saying and the principles behind it and the applications behind it. And we don't necessarily understand that. So he goes on to say in 1 Corinthians 9:23, the purpose, the whole purpose set before us is striving for a crown. Do you not know that in a race, all the runners run? How many runners run? Now, if you're in the pasture, you're supposed to be running. You're not supposed to be hanging out over in the corral. You're feeding so that you can get to the point that you can run. You can enter into the things of God to be useful in His kingdom for His purposes. All the runners run, but only one gets the prize. Run in such a way as to get the prize. He's telling this to the Christians. Why? Because they're not running. They're sitting around with folded arms. Hey, remember, these are idol worshipers, and one of their philosophers wrote, all the people sit around all day idle, and at night they go play games. There's not much has changed, huh? Our whole society is surrounded with idols and our purposes. Make money, make money, make money. That's our idol. And then we go play games in the evening. Society hasn't changed. Now, in the midst of this, Paul is demonstrating to them that there is an objective in our relational functionality with God right now. Right now. Now, we're going to talk a little bit about the race, and then we're going to talk about what is the race. We've got to define that too. But first of all, let's look and see what Paul says. Run in such a way that you get to get the prize. There is a prize. There is a crown. Now, these guys ran after for a little crown that would go on your head that was made out of grapevines and, who knows, lilac and all the rest of that stuff. Probably had some rosemary in it and twigs and bird's nest and I'm sure, you know. But there was something else that they needed. They needed to please the gods. That was the purpose of them having this thing. So even Paul is making the statement when he's saying to them, run in this thing. Get qualified for this. Because remember, they knew that if they were supposed to get qualified. They knew they were supposed to go to the gymnasium for 10 months in order to be qualified. So when he says run in such a way, he's setting forth the terms. Why aren't you in the gymnasium with God? Why aren't you learning about Him? Why aren't you putting on and getting in there and pumping iron and doing all these things? And he's making the statement, you're a runner. And you know about this stuff. There's a whole stadium built to your gods. Now get busy with your God and run after Him because you can get this prize. And there is a crown that is for us, that is a supernatural crown that we can wear in this life that will gain the attention of the angelic beings that are serving God and gain the attention of Jesus Christ because the Holy Spirit is the one that lets that rest upon us with His peace. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. What is he saying now that we got a little history? Are you in strict training or are you idle? Strict training means that you cut out the donuts. I had 2 donuts this morning. Strict training means that you don't sit on the couch and veg out in front of the boob tube. You got your nose in Scripture. You're listening to the Word when you can't be reading it. You're talking to each other about the things that God's doing in you and has done for you and how He's speaking to you. And you're with your sub-shepherd. You realize Jesus is a great shepherd, but He has these sub-shepherds because a sub-shepherd is supposed to be in charge of all the sheep in the field. And the sheep are not supposed to be telling the other sheep what to do or asking questions of the other sheep or directing the other sheep. Who's supposed to be doing that? God's sub-shepherd is supposed to be doing that. All inquiries, everything about the sheep. The sub-shepherd's the only one that can do it. He's the only one that can go out with the axe and bust the ice and get through that which is restricting them from being able to drink. A sheep can't help another sheep do that. A sheep can come together and they can face down together. They can face down the couch. They'll all get their little hinies stuck in and they're facing the couch, eyeballing them. Now, I don't know if you know this or not. Sheeps can butt. I've learned that on a personal basis. Yeah, I tell them what the Word says is, but. But the Word says, but. That's your interpretation. No, it doesn't it say, well, you read word for word, but. I've learned sheep butts. Now, that's a good thing if the enemy comes close. That's what we're supposed to butt with, our hard heads. But we're not supposed to do that against God and His Word and His instructions for our lives. Instead, we're supposed to become runners running to be in His presence. Runners, because He chose this vision, so because they understood it's the only thing that will appease the gods. And so when He says you're supposed to be running, He is saying to them, this is what will please God, is you're in this with all your heart, mind, soul, and body. Brilliant exercise here that He is giving that I think most of our theologians have looked over. The Holy Spirit carried them along with the breezes of the Spirit to talk about things that were relevant to them that they could bring in with such dynamics of everyone who competes in the games. Now, didn't He just get through say all are supposed to be runners? He's from the South, right? That's why I use that word so much, all. He didn't really mean all when He said all. Did He? All are runners. And if you want to be pleasing to God, you're going to have to find out, one, and agree with Him, you're supposed to be a runner. And two, you're supposed to be doing some strict training. And what for? Because there's something in this for the now and for the future. They do it to get a crown that will not last. I can tell you, I've seen many people out just playing soccer till they beat their brains out. And then later on in life have to give it up because it really's got nothing to do with work. I've seen many people doing gymnastics out the kazoo, but then later on they have to give it up because it really doesn't have anything to do with what life is about. It's great when you're little, and yeah, you might be able to go to the Olympics, but once you get that medal, it's going to rust. It's going to be put in some box somewhere, back in some corner, and then your great-great-great-grandkids are going to get it out, and now, Grandma, you did this, but wow, you should have practiced a little harder. Do you realize this record's been broken several times, Grandma? There's not going to be much in it for us, even if we had won something like that, that's going to impress anybody in the future. Why? Because in the future, people are going to get faster and faster and stronger, and there's not a world record that hadn't been broken and broken and broken and broken and broken. And now, if you had one of those medals and you did this and this amount of time, and in the future, somebody's doing it 2 seconds faster, and you're the slowest guy on the team's running that fast now. And the reason I'm telling you this is because our race is for a crown, and Jesus Christ is the one that crowns us. We need that crown in this life. The enemy fears if we wear the crown. It's not something we can go get. I see lots of my hardline Pentecostal friends going out, and I'm going to get the crown, I'm going to wear it, I'm going to get the mantle, I'm going to wear it. No. We only get this through strict training and through obedience to our Lord and Master, and that our eyes are only focused on Jesus and they're not focused anywhere else but on Him. And He's the one that does the crowning, not us. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like a man running aimlessly. And when I see our pseudo-Christian churches everywhere, most of them don't run. Most of them don't do anything. They think that they can satisfy God with coming and sitting on the bench and two services, one service. And then they moan and complain about that. I remind you, the Scripture says, and they met daily. The New Testament church met daily. And they also had an entire day, the Lord's day, of spending time in God's presence and with each other. And when God calls us and says, hey, come down to the gymnasium and be with me for an hour and a half, 2 hours. It's our mental incapacity and not realizing. And it's our statement of, I don't want to train. I don't want to train. And I tell you, I've been thinking about joining a gym again. Now my body says, you're too tired. My body says, you don't want to do that. The muscles say, you're going to hurt us? Oh, what are you going to do this to us for? Well, things aren't the shape they're supposed to be. I can't quite draw in enough breath. And they said, well, you think you're short of breath now? You get on that treadmill, you're going to be way short of breath. The flesh man always lies about those things that will help us, both physically and spiritually. We must be willing to do what God's Word instructs us to do. And spiritually, He says we are supposed to train, and train. And if you left your training, you were disqualified. Being disqualified means you're not a runner. Your name was taken off the list as a runner. So God's looking upon us, and we're supposed to seek Him with all of our what? Did that leave anything out? No? There may be some stuffings. Heart, mind, soul, and body. Oh, that's attached, isn't it? It's still part of it. It's supposed to be seeking God, too. Now, I'm bringing this out. He says, now, I don't run aimlessly. What's the aim? The aim is that we can know Jesus Christ here. The aim is that we can become functional with Him here. And He can lead you in everything that there is to do in your future. He can lead you through what you need to accomplish today. He knows the complications that are coming tomorrow, next week, next month, this upcoming year. I'm telling you, over the course of the next 10 years, there's going to be some absolutely devastating things that take place in your life. And you need to be in contact with Jesus now and be built up strong now for those devastating things that are going to take place then. Then you can remain calm because you will have practiced enough that you have developed a consciousness of Jesus being close by, a real consciousness of His presence. Because He says that those who are trouble-hearted, that He will come and comfort us and be with us. And He will reveal Himself to us, and that He will lead us through those things. That He will not forsake us, and He will not leave us. Now, most of the time, we forsake Him. You know, I know somebody said, you know, sent out an email to, you know, the pastor's not calling me. Well, you sent me an email that I'm not supposed to call you. I think, well, what do I do with that? If I receive that email. Now, if you tell God, don't call me, when it comes time you need something and He doesn't answer, why should you expect an answer? Because you said, don't speak to me. Now, God wants to speak to us, and part of the race that's supposed to be set before us is the knowledge that He will reveal Himself to us, the knowledge that we can walk with Him, the knowledge that He can put a crown of righteousness upon us. Why? Because there's a lot of unrighteousness within us, is there not? And I have a real problem with myself when I know I've been unrighteous. Because I know how disqualified I am from His prize and from His presence and from His fellowship and from Him speaking to me. And when I know that, then it causes me to hang my head low in shame. But in that position, I can also repent, can't I? See, that's the only position He wants us to get in, is us to get to the point and say, I won't do that anymore. That's His only interest, is for us to say that and mean that and act upon it. I won't do that. Once we don't do it anymore, it's not an issue to Him. He just wants to train us in His glorious gymnasium in His house of don't do that. Once we stop doing that, we have grown. We've come out of the diaper that fills the room with fragrant air that everybody runs from. And it was our diaper. We stop doing that, and everybody notices the character change. You don't smell the way you did. God is looking for holiness within us, and you know what His term of holiness is? Not us being religious, not us being sanctimonious, not us thinking that we're holy, not us, oh, I'm studying Scripture, I don't have time. I was talking to my aunt yesterday, and she told me about not a young man, he's my age, and when it come Christmas time, his mother's in kind of a rest home, And, well, I'm retired, and I just moved here, and I live in a small house. I only have four chairs around my table, and, you know, just tell her that I don't have room for my mother to come spend Christmas with me. She lived in the same town. My aunt was weeping about it. What was the person lacking? They said, oh, I'm a dynamite Christian. I can heal this and I can do this. And what were they lacking? Lacking character. If you want to talk about holiness, holiness can be seen in people. That holiness means that you've separated yourself, that you're in the training camp, and you're training all the time. And people around you will begin to notice, hey, you don't get ticked off as much as you used to. Hey, you're not using those four-letter words as much as you used to. Hey, you got a smile on your face. Hey, you didn't try to short me this time. You didn't cheat me out of something this time. They honestly should see a difference in you. And when there's a difference in you, then you can begin to say that you're holy because you're separated unto God. And you're practicing those things as a result of His touch and His hand and His life and His heart and His mind and His Word flowing around you and His Holy Spirit leading you and breathing upon you and teaching you. We stop being children when we start becoming obedient. If we're not obedient, we'll always be under the taskmasters, is what the Scripture says. I know, there's that dirty word that the pastor keeps using, obedience. We'll get used to it because it's the only way to enter into the games, and it's the only way to enter into the fellowship. It's the only way. He says, I beat my body and make it a slave so that after I have preached to others, I myself might not be disqualified. Wow, can you imagine Paul saying, I don't go out there and just speak about these things. I live these things because I don't want to be disqualified from seeing Him and hearing Him and knowing Him. He's the greatest treasure in my life. I don't just come and preach these things to you. I fear getting disqualified from this. That should be the heartbeat of every pastor out there. Brethren, I do not regard myself as having laid hold of it yet. But one thing I do, I forget what lays behind. What lays behind? Well, yeah, there's our poor past and our poor actions. But something else that should be laid behind too is our laziness. Something else that should be laid behind is our sitting in front of the boob tube. I'm telling you, you can spend 3 hours in the Word and have a marvelous prayer time and go spend 1 hour in TV and you have lost your spirituality. Why? It is a big suction tank put right on the presence of God and it just sucks it right out of you. Why? Because you're being exposed in the full realm of the world and it's just washing over you with its slime. You can go wash off all you want to and then get a little relief. But if you go back and do that again, then but that most Christians are in that cycle. If they sit under the Word just a little while, then they go sit in front of the boob tube. And they don't understand, why am I not growing? Well, one of those runners, where are they supposed to be every day from sun up to sundown if they honestly enlisted to be a runner in the Olympic Games to get their gods on their side? Where are they supposed to be? They're not down there watching the boob tube. Man, we've got to appease these gods. Well, I'm telling you, Scripture says you are not your own. Jesus bought you. He paid for you. If He bought you and paid for you, you are a slave. We don't act like slaves. We got our independence, and there's the problem. He says, I bought you with a price. I paid the price with my blood. I just didn't take a wheelbarrow full of gold and go buy you. I laid down my own life for you. Now, why aren't you living for me? Those are some serious questions, are they not? They're questions my soul doesn't like to answer. But you can begin to answer those now. Or you can be awfully ashamed when you get there before the Lord and you answer those questions. I'll have to answer those questions. Give an account for every, how many, what word? Idol. Idol. And I can tell you, our idols are, but Paul made a statement, I catch myself by the throat and I drag myself and I make myself exercise. I make myself do these things. I will not let my flesh keep me from the living, breathing presence of God where all the blessings are and where the crown is of righteousness. There is no peace like having Jesus move in on you and put the crown of righteousness upon you. I have never had any peace and joy as much as when He comes and He washes everything that there is and He puts that crown of righteousness. Now I know if I am pleasing to Him, there is nothing that can be against me in this world. See, my greatest fear is I might do something where God's not for me. Do you realize you can do that? Right? You can do something that will cause God not to be for you. You think if you're in adultery and you call yourself a Christian, that God's for you? He's not. You think if you're a thief, God's for you in the midst of that? Sorry, He's not. Matter of fact, he says that those who do such things, His wrath begins to build and build and build. Those in the church who do such things, this is in the New Testament, that His wrath begins to be built against those sons and daughters that call themselves His sons. His wrath begins to build. Now, subconsciously, we got this excusatology, phraseology that we have learned excusing ourselves. But inside you know when you're not pleasing to God, and you know that you have nothing to come, nothing coming from Him. But if we can get in the position that we practice what Paul is practicing here, we can get into that position where all that is cleansed and washed in a crown of righteousness, where everything in our mind knows God has completely resolved everything that there is, and there's nothing standing between me and Him. That is the greatest peace that you can have, because if He is for you, then there is nothing that can or will be against you. That is not something we know as Christians, although there's not one book in the New Testament that doesn't say it six different ways, six different times. What do you do with that? If it says it six different ways, six different times in each book of the New Testament, our covenant is talking to us. It's not talking to the world, saying you can lose God's favor. And God is saying, I want you to have my favor. And this is the way. Get in the game. Jesus came and He was a runner, was He not? He ran to establish the Father's will. He ran to find out what the Father... He would be up all night sometime after listening to a bunch of naggy disciples. You'd think they're, you know, gossip column thing going on over here. Oh, I'm the greatest. I'm the greatest. I can do this. I did this. Oh, I cast out so many demons when I went to this village. And He's, how long will I be with you guys? But they finally got it. After His death and after His resurrection, they finally got it. Finally got it. Paul comes along. Timothy, he said, also, if anyone competes in the athletics, he is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. Ah, no shortcuts. No shortcuts, please. You can't cut the corner. All along the way is God's holy fence of His Word, and it's strung up. And what we look for is the little outs. Oh, but so-and-so said this and this, so this can't possibly mean this. Bloop. When we cut under one of His truths to establish our own, we end up in that road where there's no water, there's no company, and there's no feed. And sometimes those sheep, after being there 3 days, really got thirsty. After 4 days and 5 days, they finally got hungry, and they didn't know how to get back in. And they'd stand next to the fence and holler to the other sheep, "Baa! Baa! I miss you. Oh, I want you." Can't get back in. They don't know how to get. They knew how to get out. But it's the pride of life. First of all, we see something with our eyes. I want that. It overrides what God says. Under the fence we go. Then the pride of life of, no, I won't stay within that shepherd range. I don't want anybody telling me what to do. I got to be on the other side of the fence here. But all the starving that takes place on the other side of the fence. And you can't exercise and train. You can't say that you're cared for. And if the shepherd comes after you and you kick and scream and you don't want to be rescued, He only goes after those who want to be rescued. Jesus goes after those who want to be rescued. That's why you're here. You want to be rescued. I want to be rescued. There are rules in Christian walk. That's what the whole New Testament is about and reflects in the Old Testament. But those rules are to qualify us for prize. Those rules are there for our safety. Those rules are there so that we can learn the guidelines of becoming and taking on the nature and character of God. We can't shortcut and cheat and do it our way. Do you realize if you're in the games and you're in the rules, you're not independent? If you want to be independent, you're not in a game at all. There is no independence. We're supposed to surrender to Jesus, right? There's no surrender with your independence. Surrender to the games of God. Learn how to be pleasing to Him. You're running a good race. Who cut in on you and kept you from obeying the truth? See the fences? There's usually someone who suggests we don't have to obey the truth. That's the word. And then it starts. What? Is that what that means? Oh, no kidding. So the fence is white because that's his gate that the master put there that we're supposed to go under. Wrong rumor. Wrong word. Something that the enemy wants us to do is to cut in on us, to stop us from obeying what Scripture says and to do it a different way. Said that kind of persuasion does not come from one who calls you. Remember, God's the one who's calling. He's calling us, blows his horn, as he said earlier. What was his call for? For us to come together. You can't stand off in the far corner of the desert. Yep, I hear his calling. Well, I wonder what he's going to do for me today. Oh, I know. He's calling me to get a shovel full of sand and sit down on it. And do nothing. No, when the trumpet blows, the calling is for us to come together. Any type of persuasion that persuades us to do it different than what the Word says or what the shepherd says is our own flesh or it's the enemy. And that can get us out of the race altogether and put us in that roadway where there's no food, where we just have to go up and down, no water. The course of the race is only within the boundary lines of God's tested truth, not what we want to declare is truth. Hebrews 12:12, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders. Where's a great cloud of witnesses? It's always the assembly. You know what he's using as the illustration of the great cloud of witnesses? He was using Noah, and he was using Moses, and he was using Samson. And he was using all the men of God as the cloud of witnesses. But I would suggest to you that you too are part of that cloud of witness that is supposed to help us stay on that straight and narrow path and helps us identify the things that hinder. You know, if I go out and I'm just a blimp, which I am, and I drag my feet, which I do, and I say I'm a runner, which I'm not now, I'm lying to myself. Now, can I do that? I'm going to have to lose the weight. I'm going to have to do something and learn from somebody who is, I don't know, one of those exercise people. What are they called? Trainer. What? Trainer. A trainer? Yeah, I need one of those guys. Because it's evident I'm not doing it on my own. Of course, you're not that way. Therefore, since we're surrounded by such great, let us throw off everything that hinders. Well, see, there's something that hinders. But that whatever hinders usually takes us into some kind of rebellious sin. Sin's rebellion, you know? To do something and not do it. What does Scripture say? It's sin. If God wants something done and we decide not to do it, then it's sin. It doesn't have to be that we're not going to the bars and we're not doing out drugs and we're not doing those things. If the Scripture says that we're supposed to do something and we don't do it, then that's sin. Just plain and simple. And that we can easily get entangled in. Easily. We're supposed to throw it off. That's something that the corporate fellowship. And then it says, let us run with perseverance. Now we're supposed to get on. And I learned something when I was in Montrose. The sheep could, we had some pastures there. Some of the pastures we had for 5 miles long and 2 miles wide. The sheep could be on the other side of the pasture. And here we come in a truck with grain, and it had a little grain chute out the back, and we were going to drive along for maybe a half a mile, dumping trough corn about 2 feet wide and a foot deep for 1,000 sheep, and here they come. Ba-dum, ba-dum. They didn't have trouble running 5 miles. Now, it wasn't a all out, but it was a nice little gallop. The whole cotton ball herd come. They didn't have no problem. And so God says, hey, I know you're starving. I know you have a need. And one of the things in this is that he provides a need if we're in the games. He's got the truck driving through the field, and it may be on the other side sometime so that we can run to him. He's the one that has the supply in the midst. So throw off that thing. If you're inspecting the fence and you think that bottom run that's white is a gate that the master put there, stop doing that. And start running towards the truck. Run where the shepherd is. Why? Because there's food there. Throw off that thing that's in your head and run with perseverance the race marked out for us. You don't get to mark the race. Jesus Christ is the one that marks the race. The church you fellowship in, if it's led by Jesus, the shepherd, the sub-shepherd, lays out the stakes of the race. That race is to train you to be healthy, to be well-exercised, well-maintained, well-ordered. No fighting, please. Every shepherd is equipped with a good hacksaw. If you got horns, he can fix you. He's got dehorners. Let us run that race with perseverance. It's marked out. Why do we fight the marks? Years ago, when video games came out, one of the video games I did when I was younger, it was some kind of driving something another, and whenever you started running over the fence post at the edge of the road, the steering wheel would shake, and the foot feet and the brake would shake. Boom, 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 boom. Yes, you can drive running over fence posts, but you're not going to get very far or very fast. And it's not very pleasurable. There's a place marked out for us. I would submit to you, this is the place. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus. Where's the place? It's you, Lord. See, it would be displeasing to the Lord for me to do something contrary to His Word. My eyes are fixed on Him. I can see His face. There's been many times I've not done something, and I didn't have to hear Him say, don't do that. I didn't have to hear the Holy Spirit beg me. Don't do that. As a matter of fact, if the Holy Spirit's having to beg you, you're already so deaf you won't be able to hear it. That's just our carnal nature. We don't want to hear it. If we don't want to hear something, we're not going to hear it. The Holy Spirit speaks to us softly, and if we don't want to hear it, He just turns and says, okay, you made your choice. Jesus, He is the one that sets the course for us. His sub-shepherds don't help Him make His choice about the course. His sub-shepherds simply point out the course that the Master Shepherd has laid. If we're willing to stay between the fences on the road at a good gape, then He's willing to continually feed us, and He's willing to perfect us inside, and He's willing to increase our faith so we can know Him, hear Him, and walk with Him. Why? 1 Corinthians 3:13, each man's work will become evident, for the day will show it, because it is to be revealed with fire, and the fire itself will test the quality of each man's work. How much work have you done for God? Because it's certainly not talking about your other stuff, is it? How much work? I want you to think and answer that question for yourself. Because this is, you're going to be tested in this when you stand before God. And the fire itself will test the quality of each man's work. If a man's work, which he has built on, remains, he will receive a reward. If a man's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through a fire. I would suggest to you that the fence is also strung up with wire that says, I love you. A fence of love. God helping us move in and stay in love. Make every effort to enter through the narrow door, because many, I tell you, will try to enter and will not be able to. There's all kinds of ways that people are saying that there are to God. I think, Joel Osteen on national TV said that there's many other ways to God, not just through Jesus. And I just thought, oh my goodness. You just threw up a red flag out there that everybody knows that Jesus is the way. Well, be able to identify that this is not of God. It's not what God says. Make every effort to enter through that narrow door. Jesus now has specified him standing in the doorway this way. The road just got narrower. Should we be concerned that the road's narrow? If we got our eyes fixed on Jesus, we can park the car in his garage. I don't have a problem. Well, I do have a problem parking the garage. I got too much junk in there. Many will try to enter and won't be able to do so. What happens? Whatever happens, conduct yourself in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then, whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in one spirit, contending as one man for the faith of the gospel. Do you realize the measuring stick that our Lord uses? Are we one heart, one mind, one purpose? If we are, then we're the assembled body. We're not the parts down at the parts store. Those parts at the parts store do not make a car. Matter of fact, there's so many parts in there that they just attach themselves to all kinds of things. Some of them don't even go to cars. Some go to motorcycles. Some go to bicycles. Just because it's a part shop, it doesn't mean that it is part of a vehicle. And same way with the body. Jesus Christ is looking and saying, you're supposed to be united with the body. And if you're going to be united with the body, then you're part of the body. Elsewise, you're a part. Now, yes, you can belong to him. He owns all the parts. But he expects those parts to be assembled properly and in motion and in use. If they're not in motion and use, then they're not a part of the body. They can still belong to him. They got some awful powerful answering to do for not being a part of the body. Why? Because they cost God something that he wants to accomplish, and that's the building of his kingdom. For if these qualities are yours and are increasing, they render you neither useless nor fruitful. For if these qualities are yours and are increasing, they render you neither useless nor unfruitful in the true knowledge of our Lord. He said true knowledge, because there's people that say, well, I have knowledge. There's people that say, I have truth. Well, this is true knowledge of the Lord. But these qualities are supposed to be in our nature, and they're supposed to be increasing. And if we don't have those things in our nature and they're not increasing, and we are useless in his kingdom, and we are unfruitful in his kingdom. For he who lacks these qualities is blind or short-sighted, having forgotten his purification from his former sins. What was a purification from our former sins? Anybody know? What was our former sin? Pride of life. I'm going to lead myself. We were supposed to be purified from that. Let's go on here, and it's not going on. We're stuck. Oh, we went too far. Therefore, brethren, be all the more diligent to make certain about his calling and choosing you. For as long as you practice these things, you will never stumble. For in this way, the entrance into the perpetual kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ will abundantly be supplied to you. How is that entry abundantly supplied to us? Come on. What's the entrance? If we do these things, right? if we get in the race. If we say, okay, God, I want in the race. I want to train. I want to win. You have to see the prize as His personal relationship, His personal fellowship, and the crown of righteousness. If we see that, then and we want to enter the games, then we're going to do it with all of our heart, mind, body, and soul. There was a guy, I don't remember, there was a book written and I think a movie made about Chariots of Fire. Some guy that could run. And I watched some of the old films, and when he ran, his arms were doing this, you know. And right before the game started, I think it was in the 20s, if I'm not mistaken, right before the game started, he wanted to be a missionary to China, and he got an assignment that he could go to China, and he needed to prepare for that. And they told him, no, if you're going to be an Olympus, you have to prepare for living. No, God's calling me. I need to go do this. He went and did that, and he came back, and he arrived late at the Olympics. Late. They started disqualifying him for arriving late. He hadn't practiced. He hadn't been practicing. And somebody come up and handed him a note. And the note said, everything you do, do for the glory of God. And then He will honor you. And when it come time for the race, the guy was all out and broke the world record, 100-yard dash. And then he entered the 440-yard dash. I think it was on the same day, which is a possibility. You're not supposed to run on the same day. If you run others, you're not supposed to run that one. And he got in there and ran. And when they hit the 200-yard mark, he was in the lead. And that's usually where people begin to fall out. And he picked up his pace. And he picked up his pace some more. And the last 200 yards, it was all out. And he was so far ahead again, he set a world record. And they asked him afterwards, he said, how did you do that? What did you do at that 200-yard mark, that 220, halfway point? He said, I ran with all my heart, everything that was in me, with that first 220 yards, and then with the grace of God and the power of God, I ran even harder the last 200 yards. And, of course, he won the gold medals. My point is we are halfway through this run with our Lord Jesus Christ. Many of us a little bit further down the road. Many of us are not in training. Some of us need to be. Some of us have trained a little bit, but we're not all the timers of training. You've got another half. You've got another 200 yards to go. And you can make a decision to train and train and train and be fit and be right for your God and make it your objective that you want to know Him above anything and everything that there is in this life, that you can't live without Him, and He will help change and transform you. Part of that, in our training, we can't train unless we're obedient to Him, right? That's real simple. If I got a trainer and he says, okay, pump me some iron, what am I supposed to do? Give him a bunch of lip about pumping iron? Or am I supposed to, yeah, how do I get a hold of this thing? He said, I want you to run in place for me. Well, you know, I don't do too well. I got an ankle. Run in place for me. Again, I don't give him a lip. I run in place. Why? He may have wanted to observe that I got a weak ankle so he could work on that weak ankle. He's not going to know those things unless I will do something to where he can observe me. The Lord wants to observe you. If you're willing to be trained, He's willing to train you for the last 200 yards of this faith walk with Jesus Christ in our life. He wants to reveal Himself to you. Shall we bow our hearts and our minds and our thoughts and ask Him how you can join His games? Lord, we come before You humbly and joyfully, knowing that You can train us in all things that there is. We don't want to be unfruitful. We want to be fruitful. That's fruit that's supposed to be produced for You, that we can lay before You. Oh, how our hearts swell and desire to run the race, the last of the race, and to run it right. So we pray for new strength. We pray for new understanding. We pray for new desires and new passions. And Lord, we state that we will be obedient to You, Holy Spirit, and cast down those old desires that are distracting us from You. So come and train us in all of Your ways of righteousness. In Jesus' great and powerful and precious name, I pray. Amen. anybody needs prayer, I'd be glad to pray for you. I got it right here. If not, you are dismissed. God be with you. Don't forget to be joyful. Don't forget to love each other. Don't forget to stay in unity with each other and be a part of each other's lives. It is wonderful being a part of the family of God.